Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the fourth meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item one is for the committee to continue its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the fourth road bridge. It gives me great pleasure to welcome from the former Fourth Estuary Transport Authority, FETA, Councillor Lesley Hinds, City of Edinburgh Council and final convener of FETA between 2013 and 2015. Mr Phil Wheeler, former City of Edinburgh Councillor and convener of FETA between 2009 and 2011. And Councillor Ian Chisholm, Fife Council and former board member of FETA between 2007 and 2015. Can I also welcome Barry Colford, former Chief Engineer and Bridgemaster. And can I just say that Mr Colford has went to the trouble of travelling from Philadelphia in the United States to join us for our evidence session this morning, so we're very grateful to him for that. It looks as if you've swapped one lot of inclement weather for another, Mr Colford, but welcome. And finally, can I welcome Chris Tracey, the former Engineering Services Manager at FETA. Councillor Hinds has indicated that she would like to make an opening statement, so if you'd like to do that, Councillor Hinds.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee, and I will take a few minutes if you don't mind, because I think it's very important in terms of the reputation of the people who are sitting here and also for the previous FETA. I also hope that you found the written material sent was useful for the committee. And as you know, all this material is available to the public, and FETA was a local democratic and publicly accountable organisation who made decisions at a local level, and all meetings and papers were available to the public, press and also Transport Scotland. The reason I mentioned Transport Scotland is reading the record of your meeting last week. I can assure you that Transport Scotland were kept informed and involved in all decisions taken by FETA. The draft papers for the board were sent to them. They attended board meetings, and regular meetings were held between the Bridgemaster and Transport Scotland. So the light touch, I think, was the word that was used last week, is not the words I would describe as the relationship between FETA and Transport Scotland, and in particular over the last couple of years of FETA. I would like to put on record my thanks to the staff who worked for FETA and the dedication, hard work and commitment to keeping the fourth road bridge open over the years of the FETA board. I've chaired many organisations over my years as a councillor, and really I've seen the dedication, knowledge and expertise of the staff of FETA. Under their leadership and FETA board, we kept the bridge open apart from severe weather conditions. I just wanted to go over three decisions that were taken by other people which were significant in my view for FETA in terms of maintenance, management and governance. The bridge tolls were abolished in February 2008, which was the result of a loss of up to £12 million per annum, which was used at that time to service the debt of the building of, first of all, the Fourth Road Bridge, and then used borrowing capital for bridge maintenance. FETA then had to either use its reserves, which it did, and apply for capital funding from Transport Scotland. There was regular discussion with Transport Scotland regarding capital funding and maintenance requirements with the Bridgemaster, and then that would come to the FETA board meetings. Therefore, instead of FETA being able to plan for future investment, there was uncertainty sometimes over capital funding for FETA, and now relied on the majority of the funding from Transport Scotland. So that was one reason. Second was the spending review, which took place in 2011. A 58% cut on indicative capital budget set by FETA for 2012-13 onwards for future capital maintenance. And following this cut, a prioritisation exercise was undertaken on non-committed schemes. There was committed schemes. And you will have Appendix 3, which again I was quite surprised that Transport Scotland didn't recognise the 58% cut, because it's in a paper on the 16th of December 2011, which they would have got a copy of, which makes it very clear in there that there was a 58% from the indicative capital plan approved by the board. And within that document, Appendix 3, that was sent, you will see that there was priority, and I'll not go into details, we might cover that later. And because of the reduction of this funding, the Truss End Link's remedial works did not go ahead. Thirdly, on December 2008, the Scottish Government announced their intention to build a new fourth road bridge, and in April 2010 set out the case for a single body to manage the two bridges. In February 2013, Fourth Road Bridge would transfer the responsibility, they decided, from FETA to Scottish ministers and dissolve FETA. The option to keep FETA and review its governance and operation was not recommended, as I understand, by Transport Scotland to ministers, and they agreed its abolition and transfer of the maintenance, etc., to a private company was decided to be responsible for the management and maintenance of the two road bridges, and staff would transfer from the public sector to the private sector. End of May 2015, FETA abolished. And I just want to finally talk about the last 2 years of FETA when I was convener, and there were two issues the board discussed at length and scrutinised, which gave them grave concerns. One was keeping the bridge open, having enough capital to ensure the ongoing maintenance of the bridge, and how we promised work as the capital funding continued to reduce. At every board meeting in the last year, we were all concerned about the level of capital expenditure and the future investment in the bridge to ensure it was kept open. Secondly, keeping the senior management of the bridge under the hand until the handover, who had the expertise, knowledge and trust of the staff and board. The concern of the board was so severe that if the senior staff left, especially the Bridgemaster, could FETA be sure of the continued good management of the bridge? And I say they were so concerned, they set up a subcommittee of the board to discuss staffing issues and actions they might take to keep the senior staff. Because of the concerns of the senior staff, myself, Tony, unfortunately can't be here as the vice convener, met them individually, and they voiced their deep concerns about the transfer to a private company and their role in the new structure. With myself, Tony, and Sue Bruce, the then chief executive, we met a number of meetings with staff of Transport Scotland, including the head of Transport Scotland, to press our concerns about the present and future management of the existing bridge. We were given assurances, but there can be no doubt that Transport Scotland were well aware of FETA Board's concerns regarding loss of key staff and the effect that this would have on the future management and maintenance of the bridge. So finally, I personally, and I'm sure other people from FETA, have been quite upset by the headlines about regarding FETA. On one hand, we're being blamed for not carrying out work on the Truss End links 5 years ago, even though we did not make the cut in the funding. And on the other hand, this failure has nothing to do with the work, as it was not where the fault had occurred. It can't be both. Apologies for perhaps the opening address being so long, but it's important the facts are laid out and who made the decisions. And I've not gone into any engineering issues, as I'm sure there's other people far more expert than I am on that. But for the last 2 to 3 years, I've become more of an expert in terms of engineering. And to finish off, one of my concerns was, and was voiced, was that it was almost like as if the bridge was just another road. The fourth bridge is not another road, as we can see. It's thriving for the economy of Edinburgh, for Fife, and for Scotland as a whole. Have we seen the effect that they've had with the closure? And I think we need to take that into account. It's a structure, a complicated structure. It's a bridge. It's not a road. And that was one of our concerns as we handed over the bridge, the attitude, perhaps, of the people. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Councillor Hinds. I think we all share your closing comment about the importance of the bridge to the people and the economy of Scotland. That's obviously why we're having this inquiry. I'm going to hand over to our vice convener, Adam Ingram, to kick off our questions this morning. Adam.
Okay, thank you, convener, and welcome everyone. Our first question really is, you will be aware from last week's evidence session that the cause of the failure of the Truss End link was that the pin connecting the lower end of the link to the truss had seized, and that the resulting cyclical stresses caused fatigue failure. Firstly, would you agree that does it make sense to you that this is the cause of the failure? And secondly, were you surprised at the failure? Perhaps Mr. Colford would be the appropriate person to ask firstly on that point.
Obviously, I'd find it difficult to comment on engineering matters where I haven't been directly involved. I obviously have been following the events of the since the closure, but it's difficult for me to comment on the actual method and mechanism of the failure, given that I haven't been closely involved in the analysis of that failure.
Okay, but would it be a surprise to you that particular element of the Truss End link was the cause, if you like, of the failure?
Well, as I said, it's difficult for me to comment because I don't know what the mechanism. I understand from the comments made last week at the meeting that the early indications has been that the pin has seized. But until I saw the engineering reports and make a decision on it, it's difficult for me to make a comment on that.
That's fair enough. Anyone else like to make a comment on that particular issue? Yes, Mr. Mitchell.
The issue of inspecting all the elements of this massive bridge is a complicated one, and there are techniques which can be used to inspect the structure of the bridge, ultrasonics and x-rays, things like that. But these machines are quite enormous, and to get into the little crooks and crannies of the bridge would be very difficult. And I suspect that the way that the pin seized was invisible to a visual inspection, so the only alternative would have been for a machine inspection of every element of the bridge, which would be impractical in my view.
Okay, well, we'll maybe come back and to that particular point. But could I ask about inspections of the bridge? We were informed that this area of the truss end link was previously inspected in May 2015. Can you explain how FETA assessed the need for inspections, how often this part of the structure was inspected, and how it was inspected?
Certainly. One of the requirements that are set out by the Department of Transport and adopted by the overseeing authorities in the UK is to have highway structures, including bridges, inspected on a two-yearly and a six-yearly programme. Mm-hmm. There's a general inspection every 2 years, which is a fairly routine inspection, and then a more exact inspection every 6 years, which involves a close visual inspection of every inspectable part of the structure. So that's what's required for authorities in the UK to inspect all their highway structures. Chris and I had been looking at this and forth for a long while, and we felt that this wasn't particularly suitable for such a large structure. So we developed a risk-based inspection regime based on how critical each component was, or family of components, and how vulnerable each of those was to failure. And we felt this was a better way of both focusing resources and also ensuring that the most critical and vulnerable elements were inspected. So we identified each component of the bridge, or each family of components, and determined how vulnerable they were to damage, whether it's accidental, deliberate, or terrorist damage. And we also looked at how critical each of these elements were to the structure. And combining these two pieces of information, we managed to come up with a risk-based inspection frequency, whereby some elements would be inspected more frequently than others, and that enabled us to use our resources, which are always scarce, to inspect the most vital parts of the structure. And as a result, we inspected, say, a critical component like the truss end links every 6 months. Now, my recollection is that we did indeed carry out an inspection in May, and we had been carrying out regular inspections at that frequency on the truss end links, and we did not detect any issues with the links during that inspection. Now, obviously, the links were uppermost in our mind because we'd carried out significant amounts of analysis and work on those particular elements over the years. So therefore, they were inspected. We knew these would be a critical component, and as it turned out, they were when we did our risk analysis. So that was the basis of our... It's not too common. It's a fairly unique thing, but we felt it was the way forward for such large structures. But it isn't what the guidelines are. The guidelines from issued by Department of Transport and followed by most of the overseeing departments in the UK are two-yearly and six-yearly. So our inspection was more onerous than that.
So you went over and above the guidance in terms of identifying that this is a potentially important area that you need to keep an eye on.
Yes, and there were, of course, others which were equally important, and we were doing something similar.
Okay. Can I ask if anyone was aware, if you were aware of the problems with the pins and was any special method of inspection adopted to check whether the pins were rotating correctly?
I think it's fair to say that we were always aware of the issue that the truss end link itself is a particularly different part of, say, the structure than just a normal member. It is a moving part. The pins were always a concern for not just for myself but for my predecessors, so that's why they were considered to be a critical component. One of the issues that we did know was that there was no sign of excess wear on the pin. There was no sign of movement which had been picked up in similar details or on other bridges. We did not see an excess wear on the bushes round the pin. There was nothing to say that the pin wasn't performing, and there was nothing in the inspection to say that there were any outward signs of distress on the adjacent members. We did have issues in the past where we had erected scaffolding down at that part of the structure, and the scaffolding had been destroyed simply because of the movement of the deck. We were aware that of the makeup of the pins, and we were aware it wasn't a particularly good detail, a detail where you can't easily inspect and you can't easily lubricate. Something like a pin isn't considered a good detail. And I think these things were part of our thinking when we were looking to replace the whole element, the whole truss end links, back in 2010-11.
But at that time, you didn't regard the pin as being a critical element in terms of the overall profile of the issues that you were having with the truss end links.
What we were looking at, we carried out an analysis to determine where the most highly stressed part of the whole truss end link was. Yeah. And we were focusing on the weakest part, which was the connection to the tower.
Right.
Now, that connection was severely overstressed, according to the analysis, and that was a significant concern for us, that tower cantilever bracket, under fairly light traffic loading, the analysis is showing, may rip off the tower itself. So that was a major concern to us. Okay. The analysis did not show that there was an overstress down at the pin level.
Do you think the analytical techniques need to be better in terms of your ability to assess what's happening with the pins?
Well, it's one of these difficult things, because engineering is not science. Engineering is a mixture of science and art, and it's a judgment. We have the most powerful analytical tools that we use in these, and the consulting engineers who analysed the stresses in the members, we also had an independent checker who also carried out an analysis. Now, these are the best firms in the UK and the world who are analysing and checking this using the best tools, but it's engineering. And engineering is always about judgment, rather it's not an exact science.
Okay, but there may be... you can draw on the experience of others and other bridges elsewhere. Obviously, you're based in America now, I understand, Mr. Colford, and there's lots of suspension bridges over there. Has there been any evidence of problems with pins in those bridges?
We, as FETA, and I was very keen to promote FETA, we're a member of the International Cable Supported Bridge Operators Association. It's quite an acronym, but we were very keen, and the board supported my views on this, to be part of this international community, which involves members from Golden Gate to Japan to China and other places in Europe. And I was a European member for that organisation when I was with FETA. And one of the things that it did bring was experience from elsewhere. We were aware that Humber was suffering from an issue with their end connection. That end connection does the same job as our truss end links with Humber deck, but it's a completely different structural form. But one of the things they had in theirs, it's an A-frame, but the wear in the pin was already apparent. So you could say that the failure had already occurred.
Yeah.
But because of the nature, it's in compression rather than tension. Mm-hmm. They have early warning of it. They have replaced their A-frame detail, and we were aware of that. Mm-hmm. But they had the early warning of the wear and noise which accompanied that. Yeah. There was no such indication at Forth.
We had some evidence last week that suggested that perhaps the answer in future, if you like, would be structural health monitoring. And I understand there's new technology that can be used to check on this. Was that available to you, or was that something you considered using?
Well, we do have structural health monitoring on parts of the bridge, but we have acoustic monitoring to listen for wire breaks on the main cable. We have structural health monitoring on the dehumidification system. We have GPS or GNSS systems on the bridge to look for movement of the deck. Structural health monitoring is developing on large bridges. It's been installed in the New Queen's Ferry Crossing, a significant number of sensors. It's been installed in Tsing Ma Bridge in Hong Kong and in others. My main concern with structural health monitoring is overload of data, and you really have to know what you're looking for. Hmm. The problem is that it's very useful, and it's been used a lot on existing bridges where a problem has materialised, and you need to track the progress of that problem. It's not so good for detecting problems that you're unaware of.
Okay.
Alex, did you have a supplementary on the monitoring?
A couple of very small technical points just to assist me in my understanding. Firstly, the joint that we're talking about, of course, was supposed to be moving, and the other joints were allowing some flexibility. But at the very close-up point, how much movement was there in that pin? For example, if you were to make a chalk mark across it, would you see any movement in that when the bridge was flexing?
Chris and I have been out the bridge often and seen the end moving. It does move. You can physically see it moving.
But can you see the pin rotating at all?
That's happening? That's probably not possible to do.
What I was trying to get at there, it is, on close inspection, it would be a tiny, almost imperceptible movement in the pin itself.
There is movement. No, it's not imperceptible, but it's difficult to determine how it's functioning just by visually looking at it. It's difficult to get the access to do that. You probably have to stand back some distance and look at it to see it moving.
Yes. The other thing you said was that it was a difficult joint to lubricate, and I wanted to know just a little bit more about that joint. Was it operating basically steel on steel, or was there something between the two? Was there a soft metal ring or something?
Yes, there's a bush between the pin and the steel, the cast.
Yeah,
part,
what was that
part
made of? Was it brass or something?
I think it's cast iron. They're usually made of phosphorus bronze or cast iron.
Yeah.
And what happens is that's supposed to eventually wear down. Mm. And that's what happened in Humber, for example. There was a wear problem. There doesn't seem to be, from what I can see, that may not have happened at Forth, but I don't have the analysis.
Mm.
Okay. And to determine that, you'd have to take the pin out. Unfortunately, at Forth, the pin is enclosed with and you can't get into it to either lubricate effectively or inspect. It's not a great detail. It's not one that if you were doing it again, you would design it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I think, picking up as a layman, though I learnt, like Lesley, I learnt quite a bit of engineering in my time on the FETA board. We are talking about this bridge, which is a historic monument and a living structure. It is moving all the time. I remember going out into the middle of the bridge one time with Barry to look at some element of it, and while we sat in the vehicle we're in there, West Lothian was going up and down quite markedly. So it is very much a live structure, and that's the whole point of a suspension bridge. Obviously, it takes a lot of the tension out of the whole thing. But we did have Barry's expertise, and as he said, he worked with his peer group all around the world. the emphasis very much in my time on the board was dealing with the problems with the cables, the wire breaks and so on. That was pioneering work that Barry and his team were doing on the bridge, which was then used elsewhere in the world. Other bridge operators said, oh dear, we'd better look at our cables. So that was very much where a lot of the budget had to go. And then the bolts, the cable bolts. So that's where a lot of the priorities went over the period then. And we were, as Leslie said, dependent on Transport Scotland funding.
Is there anything else on the technical aspects of the bridge and the structural health monitoring that you want to say at this stage?
I think we're very much in danger of applying too much hindsight to the engineering and design standards of the late 1950s and early 60s when the bridge was actually being designed and built. I think if it was built today, it wouldn't be built that way. And I know the new bridge has learnt lessons, as have many other bridges. Each new bridge, obviously, has learnt from the previous one.
Okay, thank you for that. Councillor Chisholm.
Yeah, just to agree with Councillor Wheeler on that point, and also the issue of the early design of the bridge is an important one, because I do recall Barry talking to one report and raising the issue of the design and the fact that the bridge was getting older, and these particular issues around the truss end was something that we needed to investigate at some point overall. But as I recall, we were coming to the end of our term as FETA board members, and I do recall asking Barry to make sure, if he could, that when the issue was handed over, that it wasn't lost in the transfer of responsibility to Amy. My worry was that and maybe other jobs would not be passed on clearly to the new...
We'll come on to the prioritisation of capital works in due course. Again, members have a range of questions that they want to ask. I think we'll leave it there, if I may. Adam, did you have any further questions?
No.
Okay, in that case, I'm going to hand over to Claire.
Thank you, Convener. A supplementary on the question that Adam was doing. FETA did scope the work for the truss end link replacement. Did the scope of that work include replacing the pins?
Yes, our works were looking at replacing the whole of the truss end link, the whole structure. Perhaps even we'd looked at one of perhaps the thing that we were looking to do was to put it up above the deck. We'd looked at other bridges where they've got a similar detail. So yes, it did.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. I'd like to move on to ask some questions about the indicative capital plan, if I may. Can you give us an indication of how the indicative capital plan was prepared each year, and how were the cost estimates arrived at for each of the proposed capital plan projects?
It's quite a challenging task, because on these structures, we're looking at doing things which are unique, and our comparators may be in New York or Hong Kong or San Francisco, where costs are completely different. So Chris and I had the difficult task of trying to determine what we would spend on priority projects over the next 20 years based on what we knew now. So it was, but that capital plan was brought to the board after we put it together based on what we felt was needed for Forth Road Bridge.
Okay.
This was a capital plan of what we felt was needed to be carried out on the bridge over 20 years. And it was quite, it's quite a challenge to determine what resurfacing will cost in year 2018-19, but that was based on prioritising based on needs of the structure as we could see looking ahead.
Do any of the board members want to comment?
Just that obviously what would happen is that the experts would come forward to the board, and there's a number of reports that we circulated. For example, the one I mentioned, the 16th of December 2011, and also the second last board meeting of the authority before it was abolished, which is the Capital Plan and Reserves update, which goes through the truss end linkages, suspended span, under deck gantries.
Board minutes, you're...
Right, sorry, we have the board minutes of the 16th of December 2011, which is Appendix 3 that we circulated, which goes through the prioritisation of priority ranking of non-committed schemes. And there was obviously, the board previously had agreed, I mean, maybe Phil might be able to answer because he was particularly at that time, but a normal process would be the discussions with Transport Scotland, because after the tolls, etc., then we had to then go to Transport Scotland in terms of grant funding. The indicative would be, say, you know, we want to invest in the bridge, in the maintenance of the bridge, and the upkeep of the bridge in future, and this would be the indicative capital plan. And the one on 2011, the 16th of December, came to the board because the indicative plan they previously decided on could not then be implemented because of the cut of 58%. The other one I'm talking about, convener, is item 5, which is Appendix 4, which is Capital Plan and Reserves update. And I was very clear, and I'm sure that Ian will back me up on this, that I wanted to make sure that we passed all the information from FETA to the new organisation, to AMI and to Transport Scotland. And that report, it has a detailed list of truss end linkage, also suspended span truss strengthening. So it has a list, I think, of around about 80 million, I think, if I remember correctly, Barry, of things of work that we believed that ongoing should be invested in. So it was an ongoing position in terms of investment. And the board would take the expert advice and prioritise it. And as I said in my opening remarks, the challenge was over the last number of years, we weren't our own destiny, I suppose, in our own setting of our budget, because we had to go to Transport Scotland for some of our funding.
A specific question on that. You referred to the Appendix 4,
yep,
where the truss end linkage work. Yeah. Again, there's a reference there to strengthening the links will cost significantly less than full replacement, yeah, which is an estimated cost of 15 million. I'm just wondering how definitive that figure is, because another FETA board paper from the 21st of February 2014, it says that full replacement has an estimated cost of between 10 and 15 million. So are you confident that 15 million was what it would cost to replace the entire link, truss end link assembly at 8 locations?
Well, that would be back to 2011. I don't know, Barry, if you wanted to, or perhaps Phil might want to do as well.
Sounds familiar.
I know it's familiar. I'm trying to establish whether it is a robust figure of what the works would cost. Can you shed any light on that, Mr. Colford?
Well, as I said earlier, what we were doing was putting indicative costs in a capital plan. Here are indicative costs of likely spend over the next 20 years. It's very difficult to determine these until you have got the contractor's cost in your hand. And we were trying to look at what these things cost elsewhere, but there weren't many places that we could go to. So we were doing the best work that we could to pick these estimates, whether it was 12 million or 15 million. These were our best estimates at the point. I remember producing a figure with Chris of 15 million. I think we may have reduced it to between 10 and 15, but it all depended on a contractor's programme, how much of the work could be done overnight, how much possession time, and in all of these things, the more disruption that you cause to users by closing carriageways or lanes to allow contractors access, the cheaper the price goes.
You think that,
down.
That 50 million figure might have, did you build in any slack into that figure?
Yes, there would be some allowance for contingencies in it. Yeah. But the basic premise of working in these live structures is that the more access you allow the contractor, the cheaper the price. But unfortunately, the more access you allow the contractor, the more the disruption there is to users. So it's a delicate balancing act.
Okay, I think that's a very reasonable point. I'll pass back to Claire.
Thank you, Convener. Last week, when we had the technical experts in, the indicative capital plan was described as a wish list for the engineers. Can you tell me what the status of the indicative capital plan was? Did you have one for every year of the operation of FETA? And of the priorities each year, I understand that the Trust Links ended up at number 5 in the latest risk assessment. But how far down the capital programme were you able to get in previous years?
The capital programme, as I described it earlier, was what we considered was needed to be done on Forth Road Bridge. It wasn't a wish list. It was what we considered was needed to be done. It wasn't what we wanted to do. It's what we felt was needed to be done. Obviously, finances come into that, and post-tolling, we were in a slightly anomalous position of FETA had the governance of the bridge, but the funding came from a third party. So we had to deal with that, but the capital programme was what we felt was needed to be carried out. Prior to the spending review, we were carrying out a capital programme. Obviously, things changed after that, and we had to reprioritise capital spending. Now, engineering is about managing risks. So when we were looking at these schemes, Chris and I and the management team had to look at what schemes could we afford to carry out. We couldn't afford to carry out all of them in a capital plan simply because there was a spending review. And we have to accept that we have to work within the monies that were granted. So we had to carry out a prioritisation of projects. The important thing is the safety of users and the safety of staff. That's number one. The second is the long-term structural integrity of the bridge. The third is potential disruption to users. Now, these were the ethos that FETA used and the philosophy that FETA used to manage and maintain Forth Road Bridge. We did as much as we could to minimise disruption to users. Lots of the work was carried out overnight, sometimes at higher financial cost and at weekends, simply because that minimised disruption to users. But the priority was the safety of our users and the safety of our staff and the long-term structural integrity of the bridge. Minimising disruption was also a priority, but these other two took precedence. And it was on that basis that we were looking at what projects would we prioritise. And as had been spoken about earlier, at that point, the main cable and the main cable anchorages and the cable band bolts were our priority. These structures are very different from other bridges. A lot of the really key elements, unfortunately, are above the heads of the very people who are using the bridge. So even carrying out an inspection on the main cable involved risk to the users. And our job was to minimise that risk. We cannot eliminate the risk, unfortunately. To eliminate the risk would be to shut the bridge completely whilst we carry out our work, and that's not possible. So our whole ethos, and what Chris and I did at all times and the staff did, was about minimising risk. And we used that philosophy when we tried to prioritise projects post the spending review. And we brought that to the board. The main cable and the main cable anchorages, if a failure occurred there, there's a catastrophic failure of the bridge. Therefore, these became a priority. If the truss end link failed, then there would be what we would term an operational failure. The risk of someone being killed or seriously injured was lower than other risks. But unfortunately, it would involve a lot of disruption. But when we risk assessed, the risk involved, the risk to projects where there was potential for structural damage or collapse or risk to life took priority. That's how we came up with the risks. Now, this difference between operational risk and structural risk is something that I'm keen to emphasise. That risk is a very difficult field. We operate in it all the time. Everyone who manages and maintains these large structures operates in this field. But it's about recognising risk. And risk is not about probability of occurrence. It's the combination of the probability something will happen and the outcome of that event. That's the field we were working in. And that's what we used to get that list of projects to move ahead with. We knew there was an issue with a lot of the projects there, but we had to prioritise them.
So the reprioritisation that took place, obviously that risk assessment would have looked at public safety. Had this been a safety critical project that needed to be funded, would are you confident that you could have approached Transport Scotland to get that funding had it been safety critical?
We had good relations with Transport Scotland following the when funding came from there. We had meetings with them. If I had gone to Transport Scotland and said there's a problem, my professional integrity would mean sure that I would have pressed that case.
Okay, and just finally, the decision to not go ahead with the full truss end replacements, but to put in place a temporary fix that would be trialled, which was carried forward by Transport Scotland. You're confident that was reasonable decision making to have made, and to continue to carry out that test and further implement the trialled repair. We're addressing your concerns about what the risks were at the truss end link at that time.
Once we'd prioritised, we revisited the analysis on the truss end links. And one of the difficulties in loadings on these types of bridges is determining or defining what traffic loading is, because traffic loading changes all the time. And traffic loading, unfortunately, depends on the mix of cars and lorries or trucks. And it can dramatically increase if you've got a nose-to-tail line of 40-tonne trucks, which was the nightmare scenario. So we looked again at risk, the risk of that happening, the risk of three 40-tonne lorries sitting nose-to-tail adjacent to the towers and stationary without cars between them to dilute the load. And the risk of that was looked at, and because we've got traffic control and because we have staff there at all times, we thought the risk of that happening was probably not... We thought the probability of it happening was quite low. Therefore, we were able to re-look at the stress levels in these elements, and it made me more comfortable about the stress levels in the truss end links. In addition, the probability of that load occurring is dependent on time. If you were going to let this situation go for 50 years, that's different than from 5 years, and we knew that traffic would be taken off the bridge to put certainly heavy traffic to go on to the new crossing. So all these thoughts were in our minds when we were looking at the reanalysis, and it gave all of us some comfort that the stress levels might reduce. As engineers, of course, we're always looking for something else, and we knew that in the past, before this weakness in the truss end links was identified, that over 200-tonne abnormal loads had crossed the bridge, and we'd inspected this weak weld detail, and there was no problems with it. So it actually had withstood a working trial, if you like, a test loading. In fact, I think we had a 238-tonne transformer going across at one time in the past. So we knew that these loads had gone without any ill effects. But again, this is the whole nature of engineering. The analysis is telling us something, but we know in real life or real time that an actual larger load had crossed the bridge without causing the weld to rip off the tower.
Okay, that's fine. Councillor Hinds, did you want to come in on those points? No, that's...
I think maybe more Phil, to be honest, okay, because it was during this time in terms of that 2011.
I certainly endorse what we're hearing from Barry, that obviously we had the guidance and the prioritisation programme that he came forward with as to what was doable within the budget. That is one of the basic things in politics, the art of the possible. You folk will know that as well. And we had to work within that constraint. You were talking, Ms. Adamson, about the difference between 10 and 15 million for doing that work. My recollection from conversations with Barry about costing for different big contracts on the bridge was there were a very limited number of contractors who actually had the skills to be let near the bridge. And that meant it wasn't all that competitive tendering process. If there were only two or three firms that actually had the ability to come forward. So that meant that put pressure on the pricing as well. But certainly from the time the decision was made to build the new bridge, I got the impression that there was always a pressure on FETA only to carry out the absolutely necessary work, essential work, to nurse the bridge through until the new crossing was available. And the work I touched on before, the cable work and the work on the bolts and so on, they were items one and two on the list, and they were our priorities. We noted there were a lot of other things that should be seen to, but they just had to be pended for that time.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Chisholm, did you want to add anything at this stage?
Only that my recollection was that if an issue cropped up regarding the safety of the bridge, we were never refused any funding from Transport Scotland to go ahead with anything that was considered to be a vital safety issue. One in the wider spectrum could see that eventually the whole bridge would have to be replaced piecemeal by piecemeal, a bit like the chap that has, say, 10 broom handles and 15 brush heads. We wouldn't be left with the original bridge. Ultimately, whether now, in 10 years or 50 years, most of the components of the bridge would have had to be replaced. And as Councillor Wheeler said, you know, with the advent of the new bridge on the horizon, it meant that we had to be careful of priorities. But I do recall that Barry had been quizzed about the priorities on the truss end links, and I got the impression that it wasn't an immediate priority. It was probably a design issue from way back that really needed to be looked at, and I got the impression we were talking about 10, maybe 15 years in the future, and that's why I was concerned that information was passed on to Amy so that it was followed up and not lost in the transfer. Yeah,
thank you very much. We may come back to that. David.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. My initial question is to Mr. Colford. You worked for 19 years on the bridge, is that correct? And how old's the bridge? About 52 years, so old currently. You've had, if I say so, probably exceptional experience and expertise on the bridge. Can I just take you back to a couple of key issues? I think it was 2010 that FETA advertised for consultants for a contract to replace the truss end links remedial works. Was that correct?
As far as I recollect, yes.
And could you just perhaps go through, for the purposes of the committee, why was that decision taken in 2010 to advertise for these consultants and to carry out a contract?
Well, at that time, we were proposing to replace the truss end links. We had carried out a feasibility study. I remember we had a workshop with our consulting engineer who was advising us at the time with our staff, because more often than not, the best ideas come from the guys who are actually working out there. So they were involved with a workshop. What would be the best way of replacing the elements and designing them, and what future maintenance was uppermost in our mind? So we were down the road of designing or putting the feasibility study together for replacing the truss end links. At the next stage, after having got together a feasibility study, so we knew that the engineering was feasible, we could do it. The next stage is to advertise for an engineer to design the works. It's part of the procurement process. We have someone who helps us out with the initial feasibility, and then we go to tender to bring in a consulting engineer to design the work. So that was the stage we were at that point.
And prior to that, obviously this was the decision of FETA board. Was this a unanimous decision of the FETA board to go ahead?
As far as I remember, yes.
Okay, thank you. I suppose the key question for me, if the work had been carried out, and I understand it was pulled back, but if the work had been carried out, might this have avoided the bridge closing last year?
Well, as an engineer, I don't really want to answer hypothetical questions, but all I can say is that we had intended at that point to replace the truss end links.
Okay. Could you just explain again to the committee why was the contract cancelled? Because as I understand it, you'd actually advertised in the press for consultants. You hadn't actually appointed them. It was ceased between advertising and appointment. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And why did that happen? Was this 100% FETA's decision, or was there any other forces?
Well, FETA made the decision, but we make these decisions based on funding availability.
Okay. Right. What was the role of Transport Scotland, Scottish Government, over your decision-making?
As I said earlier, FETA were in the position where we had the governance, but not the funding. And that's quite a difficult position for any organisation to be in. It was our responsibility to manage and maintain Forth Road Bridge, but we had to rely on funding from Scottish Government via Transport Scotland. But our relations were good with Transport Scotland, and we prepared the capital programme. The board approved the capital programme or plan, and then we had to ensure that we got the money for that capital programme or plan, and that involved negotiation and discussion with Transport Scotland.
I mean, did Transport Scotland pull the plug on the funding for this project?
Well, the funding came from Transport Scotland and Scottish Government, so I think the answer to the question is self-evident.
Which is that they did?
Well, we didn't have the funding. We had a spending review, and we had to reprioritise our projects. So that was one of the decisions that we had to make. We made the decision, but the decision was made because of the spending review.
Last week, and I'm sure you've read the official record, and some of my colleagues have already used the quotes I was going to quote, is that Transport Scotland had a light touch in terms of organisation with you, and that secondly, that your capital programme was a wish list. How would you respond to these comments from last week?
I think I've tried to say that from our point of view, Chris and I, we determined the capital plan and programme based on, we used risk in that process as well. And it's quite a complex thing. If you do one thing, how does that affect another element in the bridge? If you replace one part, how does it affect future and access and spend? So we used risk techniques to determine the priority of projects and the order in which we would do them. But this was a list of, it wasn't a list, it was a capital plan of what was needed on Forth Road Bridge in our professional judgment. I'm sorry, I didn't answer the other question because I've forgotten what it was.
Right. Well, can I... other issue was about it being a light...
If you haven't forgotten the question, perhaps you could repeat it.
Yes, I'm just going to do it, Convener. Yeah. The other issue was about that Transport Scotland had, you know, a light touch, the implication being that basically you made all decisions and they were just in the background.
It sounds a terribly political question, that. I can only tell you what my experience of working. We had close relations with Transport Scotland. They were engineers who had experience of bridges, who attended the meetings. They understood the issues, they understood the problems. We understood, from our side, the funding issues as well. It was a realistic relationship. They had funding pressures, of course. Of course they did. We were in a situation before that the monies were ring-fenced for funding the bridge. We were now in a different place, and we had to be realistic about that. And our relationships are good. I don't recognise any of these terms as light touch or whatever. All I recognise is that we had a job to do as engineers. We would put forward what we felt was needed to be done. And then we had a discussion with Transport Scotland on that issue.
So it's fair, perhaps, to describe your environment as sort of pre-tolls and post-tolls. So pre-tolls, the bulk of the income, I think Councillor Hinds mentioned, it's £12 million, would have gone, by and large, towards maintenance. But in addition, you could borrow as well, and that could also go on. But post-tolls, you're basically reliant on funding from Transport Scotland.
Well, before, when we have... had tolls in Forth Road Bridge. FETA was formed in 2002 with the view to funding projects which might decrease congestion or increase public transport usage across the Forth. And FETA, I think, spent about £17 million on other projects, ferry toll, park and ride contribution, roads and Rosyth, the approach to Fourth Road Bridge, the A8000. Mm. FETA spent some of the toll money on that. Prior to 2002, all of the monies were spent in the maintenance and operation of the bridge. But even post-2002, up to abolition, the majority of the toll money was spent on maintaining the bridge.
Okay.
Post-2008, we were in a different era. Mm. The management and maintenance of the bridge had to compete, obviously, with other transportation projects, which were competing with other public-funded projects. Mm. So it was a completely different era.
Mm. So it was more difficult to control your destiny?
I wasn't in control of the funding of my destiny after 2008, so yes, it was more difficult.
The other point I was going to raise then, obviously, you didn't go ahead with the project. Was there any prospects of you borrowing to carry out the project under your own steam?
We looked at borrowing, and as far as I remember it, FETA would have been able to borrow, but in speaking to our Treasury people who advised us from the City of Edinburgh, it wasn't a practical proposition to do, especially as FETA was going to be wound up when the new crossing opened.
Can I just say on that point, I did speak to the finance people yesterday in the council who were responsible for the finance and supporting FETA, and they said that they still had the borrowing, they could still borrow the same, they still had that. But in fact, but the discussions, as I understand it, they had with Transport Scotland, they were not keen for that to happen. So they could have borrowed the money to be able to invest, and that was directly, I had the conversation yesterday, but Transport Scotland were not keen on that suggestion of borrowing money.
And my final,
would have been happy to lend to an organisation that didn't have a revenue stream to fund the repayment.
Mm-hmm.
The revenue would have had to come, from Transport Scotland, and that was the reasons why.
Yeah, so banks would have been a bit more concerned about the sort of collateral position.
Yeah.
And my final point, Convener, is if I can just quote from page 7 of the FETA papers, and it's point 3.10. Do you recognise this quote, Mr. Coffin, and I quote, "The strengthening of the truss end links is vital to maintain the operational capacity of the bridge to carry heavy abnormal loads, and for that reason, I recommend the work is also retained within the programme."
Sorry, can you remind me what date that was?
That was 26th October 2012.
Yes, and I think the key word here is operational capacity.
Right.
And that, as I said earlier, came into our thinking when we were looking at prioritisation of projects post spending review September 2011.
Mm.
Yes, I do remember writing those words.
I think I said final, but final, Convener, is can I just confirm, because I asked this a question in finance last week, which Transport Scotland effectively denied was this the case. Can you just confirm this? September 2011 spending review, you had a 58% cut in FETA's capital programme. Was that correct or incorrect?
Well, those were the figures that the Treasury officials in City of Edinburgh and Chris and I had sat down. I believe I've seen a figure of 65 quoted by Audit Scotland, and I would have to say that I would bow to their superior knowledge. I'm a mere engineer. 58% was what we had calculated, but that was what I had reported to the board as the figure reduced from our spending programme in 2011 in February to what we had after the spending review in September.
I think the official record will show from last week that when I asked the same question, said they didn't recognise that figure. But whether it's 58 or 65, it's still... Councillor Hinds?
Could I just come back to the report, which was on the 16th of December 2011, Review of Capital Projects. Transport Scotland would receive the draft reports and would have a discussion. I'm aware of that. Because, well, without telling any secrets, there were times when they weren't particularly happy. They weren't particularly happy with some of the wording in the last, perhaps, year or 2 years, and we'd asked them to perhaps change some of the wording. So I'm aware that Transport Scotland were given draft reports, were aware of this, and that's why I was quite surprised when I read that they weren't aware of it, because it's in the report, and I think normally they would send someone to the board meeting as well, and all of these documents, which is from the 16th of December 2011, And at the back, it says, a conclusion, the proposed three-year capital grant to FETA has been reduced by 58% as a result of the review authority's capital plan over the period has been carried out. And that was following the funding review. So if they had some concern about the 58% or weren't aware of it, they must have been aware of it. If they had some concern, you would have thought at the meeting, or they would have approached the convener, or would approach the Bridgemaster to say they had concern regarding that figure. So that figure is in black and white, and was considered by the board. So, you know, and by the finance people, the experts who deal with the bridge at time day to day.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Right, perhaps I could ask some questions, Mr. Colford. Just a simple one. For clarification, the issue with the truss end link member and the issue with the pin joint that we discussed earlier and that featured prominently in our evidence last week, do you believe that these could have been foreseen?
I had obviously been thinking about that for quite some time, and my answer to that would be no, I don't think it could have been. We did carry out our inspections. And I don't think it was foreseeable. I don't think the issue was foreseeable. And I don't think we spent a lot of time looking at the truss end links. We had a lot of consulting engineers assisting us looking at the truss end links. And we didn't foresee the issue with the pin sticking, if that's indeed what the mechanism for failure was.
Okay. Thank you for that. I just thought it'd be helpful to have that on the record. Because of your extensive expertise, as my colleague Mr. Stewart has already referred to, forgive me if I direct most of my questions to you, although I do want to bring in our other panel members. But can I just ask you, as the former bridge master responsible for the Fourth Road Bridge, we learnt last week that FETA had been looking at works to replace the truss end assembly since 2006. That was something that Mr. Lees from Transport Scotland had said. In 2009, a preliminary preferred option was identified, which would have seen the entire truss end link assembly replaced at 8 locations at an estimated cost, which we discussed earlier, between £10 and £15 million. In 2011, FETA decided not to proceed with that option for reasons that we've alluded to. They decided instead to proceed with a trial of the strengthening work at one of the towers, work which commenced in May 2015. Now, what I'd like to know, and what I'm sure the public would be keen to know, is why, when the need for maintenance work was identified in 2006, it is a further 9 years before that work is commenced. Can you perhaps explain the reasons for the delay and what the consequences of that decision to delay that work would have been?
I can certainly go through the chronology of where we were. In 2006, we identified the scheme to replace the links from... The links are part of the suspended span truss, which is a huge piece of engineering. And we were carrying out an analysis of that suspended span truss, an assessment of it. And we had one firm of consulting engineers doing it, as I said earlier, another firm independently checking it. Now, it is quite an undertaking. And in all of these things, they both carry out an analysis, they both run their computer models, their finite element models, and they come up with answers and after putting loads in, and then we spend time trying to get agreement between the answers. That took up an awful long time, but we finally did. We identified that significant elements of the truss were overstressed. Significant elements of the truss were overstressed, including the links and including the connection to the side towers as well. So there are significant members within that truss were overstressed, but getting down to the actual final agreement between the two sets of consulting engineers as to certify the analysis and the check took some time before we got agreement on that. In 2010-11, we certainly had identified that we needed to replace the truss end links. That was then they were put on the capital programme.
So what's the reason for the delay between 2011 and 2015 then? Since you've done all the preparatory work, you know what needs to be done, but there's still this further delay. What's the reason for that?
Well, the spending review meant that we had to prioritise, as we said, and we had a further look at the truss end links to see, look at further detailed analysis of them to see if there was anything else that we could do with live loading, traffic loading, to reduce the stresses within the members that we were most concerned about, which were the connection to the towers And again, we had difficulties with both the numbers and the analysis, getting agreement between those. But we also had difficulties in how we were going to actually strengthen them. Is there anything that we could do to strengthen these weak elements without full replacement? And that was what concentrated our minds between that period. But one of the, I guess, ironic issues was that what we were concerned about was that when we were repairing the welding, we would get burn through in the paint and the towers, and how we would repair that burn through with the movement of the truss end links. How could we send our operatives down there when we knew that the scaffolding had been crushed and we knew that the truss end links was moving between the end of the truss and the tower? So it was a matter of how do we get people down there, and that took a long time to try and determine.
So very real, practical, logistical.
Yes, and mainly it was issues. How, and the access into the towers is very, very difficult. How do we put welders in there if we could over-weld on the existing welding? And in addition, there was concern, real concern, about the quality of the steel within the towers. Steel in the towers at that period did have a number of laminations in it and slag, and it sometimes is termed dirty steel. And it's quite difficult to weld to. And we had real concerns that we would be able to over-weld on this detail. So we also had to carry out trials to determine whether we could over-weld on the detail or not. So all this took a considerable amount of time and effort. But you've also got to balance that with, there were other things happening. Our main concerns at that time were the main cable and the main cable anchorages and the cable band bolts. Our concerns were the structural integrity of the bridge. And whilst we're not forgetting about the truss end links, we know in our prioritisation that a failure there is an operational failure, whereas failure in a main cable or a main cable anchorage is about safety of the public and the structural long-term structural integrity of the bridge. Because if the main cable anchorages of Forth Road Bridge fail or the main cable fails, there's a risk of life to the people who are using it. There's an obvious risk to the long-term future of the economy of the region. Yep. But there's also another risk which is sometimes thought about, is that you may have a structure lying in a river and there's things go on in Rosyth and Port of Grangemouth. These risks have got to be thought about when you're looking at determining funding for these structures.
So there's clearly a lengthy delay, whether you consider that to be the 9 years since 2006 or the 4 or 5 years since 2011, but you're saying that through your management of risk, you're always prioritising any work that is safety critical, even though all of the work that you've identified as needing to be done is ultimately work that is the failure of which to undertake threatens the long-term structural integrity of the bridge. Would that be a fair assessment?
No, only some of it does. Right. Only some of the works are... So you've got to divide it into an operational risk or a structural risk. But I think you can divide the timeline into two parts. What happens prior to September 2011 and what happens after that?
Okay, that's helpful. And I think that this distinction between operational and safety critical, if we want to characterise it in that way, is helpful. Really, we're trying to understand whether there are repairs that should have been done, that were done within timescales that are reasonable in terms of public safety, or appropriate in terms of public safety, and reasonable in terms of what would be considered good practice within the industry. So you would obviously argue that was the approach that you took.
Yes, obviously my view has to be somewhat coloured because I was directly involved. But on looking back at it, I don't think there was much more that we could have done within that period. As I say, before 2011, we were concerned with the analysis of the truss at that point and the results of that. But once we had established that we had significant overstress on those connections between the truss end link, cantilever brackets and the tower. Then we decided that we would put that in our capital plan to replace them. Subsequent to 2011, we had to make other decisions based on the prioritisation of these projects. And we decided, we were then looking for a technical solution, an engineering solution, to see if we could possibly strengthen the links to help us in this problem, to help us out in this problem. And that took quite a bit of effort and time because it is a unique problem. And there were unique engineering and technical matters that had to be developed. You have to spend the time considering these before. You can't just rush in and do something in these respects. You have got to spend time looking at the engineering and what's possible and what's not possible. And safety of the people who are doing the works is paramount as well.
Okay, so you've talked about engineering being about managing risk. You've talked about the need to minimise the risk to the staff and the public. Can I ask you a question which I asked our witnesses last week? In view of all of that, and with the benefit of hindsight, was the postponement of that larger piece of work, the replacement of the entire truss end link assembly at a cost of £10 to £15 million, was the decision to postpone that work and to look at a more cost-effective trial, was that decision reasonable? And, you know, we had a range of responses to that question last week, ranging from reasonable and appropriate from the Transport Scotland witnesses. Amy suggested that that FETA made the right decision and that the area was not overstressed. And Mr Hornby from ARUP suggested that the correct assessment was made at that time. So would your view depart from any of those? What would your assessment be?
All I can say is that at the time, FETA's view was that we should replace the whole assembly. We did not have the funding to do that, so we had to look at the an alternative. If we had strengthened, as we thought there would be an option to do, the failure would have likely still occurred because it wasn't in the point where we were focusing our efforts to strengthen at.
Okay, perhaps I could put the question in a slightly different way. This is also a question that I posed to Transport Scotland last week. So, is your assessment of the evidence that no safety critical work was postponed or not undertaken because of the budgetary constraints that you were operating within?
I go back, sorry, I don't mean to be not answering the question directly, but safety critical is not quite a term that I would recognise. You have to look at risk and determine, is that risk, is there a risk to life, is there a risk to the structural integrity, a long-term structural integrity of the bridge, or is it an operational risk? So you've got to divide that.
So which
risk
was it then in terms of that?
Operational. Right. The risk of failure of the truss end links was operational. The main risk would have been disruption to users, because we knew that a step would develop, or a potential for a step would develop at the joint. Now, that may have caused an accident for a user at the time, but the main risk was in disruption. There was not a threat to the structural integrity of the bridge, and there was not a threat to the safety of the majority of the users of the bridge. And that's how we have to look at these things.
I think that's very clear. I think that's very helpful.
I'm not quite sure I've answered your question, though.
I think you have.
Have you?
Obviously, the official record will reveal whether you have or not. Mr Wheeler.
Thank you, Convener. Just a comment on that. Obviously, you've quoted from the evidence you heard last week that all the different experts were saying it was the correct decision. And that was the guidance we had at the board. We had no reason to overrule that guidance or to change it. We had to go along with what the experts and our bridge master told us. So that's why the board made that decision, and I'm pretty sure it was unanimous. The board was normally pretty solid in its support of the management, but we did ask a lot of critical questions from time to time, Ian Chisholm being a particular questioner from time to time. But I'm sure that we were satisfied with the technical answers we were getting.
Okay. Can I ask Councillor Hinds? You've already talked about the cut to the capital budget. Earlier you said that was very, it was in black and white, that there had been a cut to the capital budget, and that was something which had a direct bearing on the decisions that you took at the FETA board. Is that right?
That's correct, yeah.
Okay. And the decision that was taken by FETA was not to proceed with that larger piece of work, which was estimated to cost between £10 and £15 million. If this maintenance work was work that, you, that had been identified by the experts as being necessary, why did you as convener and your predecessor as convener not make the case to the FETA board and to Transport Scotland for the funds to be committed to undertake this work?
Because there was a spending review we put forward, and obviously it was Phil at the time, there was a spending review. We had an indicative capital plan which included the truss end links and total replacement of the truss end links, and that was the plan that FETA and the board wished to do. Now, if you're suggesting that we challenge a spending review, and that may well be more Phil than myself, but obviously the Bridgemaster would be challenging and trying to put forward the view that for more resources, that was an indicative budget that he believed professionally was the money we needed in order to invest in the bridge to ensure that we kept the bridge open. Okay. And we kept the maintenance of the
That's
bridge.
That's helpful. I understand that.
Convener, was to keep the bridge going as best it could until the new bridge came on stream, and hopefully nothing would go wrong with the existing bridge. That's definitely the messages we were getting.
I should just add that there were a lot of other operational risks on that capital plan which we couldn't carry out. The surfacing of the bridge is only an inch and a quarter or 38 millimetres thick. There is a risk of debonding of that surfacing, and if that happens, then we have to close a carriageway or close a lane. Now, that's an operational risk. It does not threaten the structural integrity of the bridge. It doesn't threaten the safety of users, but it would cause massive disruption. So the truss end links weren't the only capital project that had to be deferred because of the spending review. So there were lots of other projects with an operational risk, but not a risk to structural integrity of the bridge.
Okay, but just if I could ask Councillor Hinds, we heard in evidence last week from Mr. Lees of Transport Scotland, who said, and I quote, FETA could have used its reserves or come to Transport Scotland and asked for help. I have found no evidence of that, so I consider that the risk was deemed to be manageable. What's your response to that, and is that your view? Is that a correct assessment of the situation that FETA faced at that time?
We had reserves that we needed. For example, one of the projects that came as an emergency, as I understand it, £5 million was needed for that project, and we needed to use the reserves. So there would be a discussion between Transport Scotland and the Bridgemaster regarding what we would use in reserves and what we would then try to get from funding from Transport Scotland. And that would be the discussion we would have. But the spending review was a decision by the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland of the money that they allocated to FETA. And therefore, that was the money they had. FETA also used its reserves, but also, an advice, again, speaking to the finance officers yesterday from the council, is that also Transport Scotland would be asking to make sure that we kept in reserves. And that was one of the concerns we had as a board regarding the last year. In fact, our reserves got down and down and down. And the only reason that we may well be passing over around about, I think, 3 or 4 million is because of a court case that we're not allowed to discuss, but there was funding that came from that, and that's the reason why. But we were getting down to a situation, reserves in the last year, that no other, I don't think, local authority or other public organisation would want to get those reserves down. In case there was some emergency, that's what you keep the reserves for. But there was a discussion between the Bridgemaster, Transport Scotland, and then with FETA, and the board discussed that about using, and there's reports here that you can look through, but we used the reserves when we thought it was appropriate in discussions, and we tried to get as much funding as we could from Transport Scotland as well.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Barry,
can I ask the same question of the other board, the other former convener and the board member, and then bring you back in, Mr. Colford? So going back to the Transport Scotland evidence from last week, FETA could have used its reserves or come to Transport Scotland and asked for help. What's your response to that?
Yes, I'm sure that that was theoretically possible, but we're told that as a result of the spending review that really we'd have to make do with what we've got unless there was a real emergency. Okay. That's definitely my recollection of the situation at that time.
Okay, and Councillor Chisholm?
Yeah, I don't think that we as a board would ever have wanted to reduce our reserves to a dangerous level, and I doubt if Audit Scotland would be happy with that either. We were always concerned, and it came up at board meetings quite a lot, that we wanted to hand over the bridge in good condition and as safely as possible to Amy, because we had taken pride, at least since I was on the board since 2007, of the way that we'd run the bridge and maintained the bridge, despite many crises, which were down to an ageing structure and an increasing load, which it was never designed for. But we felt we'd done a great job and we wanted to hand over a fully operational bridge to Amy. And it's worthwhile noting that during our period, or my period, 2007 to when FETA was disbanded, we never actually had a full closure of the bridge. We never closed the bridge completely. Lanes might have been closed at times, but I'm pretty certain that we never closed the bridge. And so it was a real disappointment when it was fully closed. But I think it's worthwhile also pointing out the things that Barry was talking about, operational risks, because even with this...
So my question was about why FETA did not go back to Transport Scotland and make the case for this work to be done.
Well, because
it was deemed to be necessary. That was my question.
In 2015, when we were nearing the end of our term, there was the proposals to do a pilot welding to see if that was going to be
I think we'll leave it there. Mr. Colford, you wanted to come in.
I think it's fair to say that the value of the reserves would not have covered the work that was needed to be done in the capital plan. However, my discussions with Transport Scotland, we both recognised the risks. They were well aware of the approach we were taking and supported us in our risk-based approach to prioritisation of projects. And we both, and I say we both, I mean both FETA officials and Transport Scotland officials recognised that the risk for the truss end links was an operational one. Therefore, the prioritisation was put forward to the board and approved based on the fact that this was an operational risk. If I had gone to Transport Scotland and said...
To be clear, the postponement of this larger piece of work, along with some other projects that had to be weighed in the balance, that was an operational risk and an acceptable risk.
Well, it depends if you find that the operational risk is acceptable or not. It was a I prioritised risk.
That just doesn't for your view. So you have the floor to say.
That doesn't mean to say that any risk is whatever is acceptable. An acceptance of risk is a very subjective thing. All we did was prioritise risk based on those philosophies of safety of the public and the staff, the long-term structural integrity of the bridge, and disruption. In our priorities, disruption was lower than the first two.
Right. So you would say that it was an operational risk, but you wouldn't go beyond that to say it was acceptable or reasonable or the correct
Well, I reported to the board on these matters, and the board may have taken a political view or a view as the board whether these risks were acceptable or not. But my job as an engineer is to present the risk and show where the priorities were.
Okay.
The matter of whether a risk is acceptable or not is quite a subjective one.
Does anyone else want to have a go at that?
We just repeat it. It's that the replacing the truss head links and other projects were in the indicative capital plan. Mm-hmm. So as far as FETA board was concerned, as far as the Bridgemaster and the management team, was that these were works that needed to be carried out. Okay. So whether at risk, medium, low, or whatever, high, or whatever, they were the projects they believed needed to be carried out for the integrity of the bridge and for the maintenance of the bridge. A spending review then came along, which cut that funding, and therefore they took the judgment and the priorities, and that was reported. And yes, we could have gone, I'm sure, back, and I'm sure the answer would have been no. And I think that would have been quite clear of that. Therefore, the replacing the Truss End links was not seen a priority. If you look at the list, then the priorities that were there were ones that were, as has been said already, would be the main cable, cable acoustic monitoring. These kind of ones that were seen at the time of actual real risk of the closure of the ridge.
Okay, thank you for that. Did you want to add anything, Mr. Wheeler?
Just to reiterate, I think what I said before, that the board was guided by all the different experts, that it was acceptable to postpone that work at that time. You heard that evidence last week, and we endorse that today.
Okay. Councillor Chisholm.
The Truss End Link work was never put off, if you want. It was a job that had to be done at some point, and coming to the end of our term, we wanted to make sure that work was followed through. As I've said before, that given all the problems we have of maintaining traffic flow between Edinburgh and Fife, we did have to have a political eye to the closure of, or major closure of any of the bridge lanes. I mean, folk are trying to get home from their work. It's very important to Fife, and I hope we can talk about the tolls and things later and the funding of the bridge, because it's an important issue, as well as the safety and the operational risks of the bridge.
Okay, thank you very much. We're going to move on now and ask Mike.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. Just a couple of points of clarification, really. It's my understanding, just reading the briefing and so on, that the part of the Truss End Link that was thought to be critical and in most in danger of failing was the bracket to the main tower. And so that was the the work that's been taken forward, and I think you've explained the reason for technical challenges that had to be addressed and just how that was done, but it resulted in a 4 or 5 year period or so before the work eventually could be done. Am I correct in that? It was the bracket, not the pin and associated member that recently failed, that was thought to be the problem.
Yes, you're correct. It was actually the bracket and the weld, especially the weld of the bracket to the back of the tower. It's not a particularly good detail, I have to say. The bridge is a fantastic piece of engineering, but there are places where quite clearly not enough thought was given to what might happen in the future. That is a poor detail. And it's, as an engineer, when you look at it, you can see that it's a poor detail. We were particularly concerned about that weld. It was an intermittent weld. But what we were doing when we carried out the trial to try and strengthen it was really a trial, because we were not sure whether we could overweld on it, whether the steel underneath was good enough to take the overweld. As I understand it, the trial has been a success. That was taken on or continued by Amy, but Chris and I were involved heavily in that. But even to get people in there was very difficult, to get the welders in and the equipment and the ventilation. But it was the bracket and more especially the weld detail to the end. It was in danger of ripping off the tower.
Yeah, and it's just irony, I suppose, that the weakest link didn't fail, but a stronger link failed.
Yes, it is. It is. It could be described as ironic, but it did.
Yeah, and you've talked a wee bit about your method of risk assessment, risk evaluation, and if my understanding's correct, you know that's a combination of the probability of failure and the severity of the consequences of failure if the failure occurred. In your professional opinion, given all your experience, notwithstanding the fact that it took, a number of years because of the technical challenges to address this bracket welding, that was reasonable under the circumstances, that you weren't so concerned about, a few years' delay because your risk assessment had indicated that, you know, this is not a desperately urgent problem. We can live with 4 or 5 years of delay. And I'm not suggesting otherwise. It seems to me that what you've been saying, in a sense, was that was a reasonable position to take given the probability and the consequences that go into risk assessment.
Yes, and as I said earlier, there are a couple of things that gave us some comfort. One was that we knew there had been very large loads crossed over the bridge in the past, which in theory should have caused an overstress so significant on those welds that they should have failed and they hadn't.
Yep.
Because it's engineering.
Yep. Yep.
So we knew that. We also knew that the probability of the traffic loading pattern to cause the failure was low. The probability of occurrence was low.
Yeah.
But the outcome was high.
Yeah.
So the risk was high.
Yeah.
And we could control that probability of occurrence. So we had that comfort as well.
Yeah.
So that helped us in having some time to do it. It gave us the comfort of being able to find the right solution for it. And it took some time to do that because there were a number of real technical challenges in carrying out a modification or a trial to that truss end link.
Yep. Yep.
It didn't mean to say that we were laggard in it or that we set it to the side. It was one of the constant worries on the bridge, along with the cable anchorages, the end of the truss members themselves, the main cable, the suspender. It's a lively old structure designed to take half the traffic loading that it takes now. It continually needed work and funding. And our whole job was to look at the issues, but manage them based on probability and risk.
Yeah. And just my final question, you talked about the indicative capital programme and the difficulty of looking forward into the future and getting accurate costings there and so on, and absolutely accept that. That £15 million programme, I'm just not clear absolutely. Was that capital programme developed with the knowledge that the new bridge was going ahead, or was it developed without that knowledge?
That's a good question. At the time of when we were developing our capital programme, we did put feelers out to ask questions about what's happening in the future, and I do remember quite clearly the result of that was that we should plan. We didn't know basically whether there would be what traffic would be using the new crossing, what traffic would be using the existing crossing. Therefore, we had to plan based on the loading, traffic loading, that was there on Forth Road Bridge and might be there in the future. So that was the basis of the planning for the capital plan, that was the what we had at the time, and what we went forward with.
Okay, thank you. No further questions. Thanks.
Mr. Colford, you've just alluded to the new Queens Ferry crossing. Can I just ask you, just so that we've captured that for the record, what bearing, if any, did the proposal to proceed with the new Queens Ferry crossing have on the risk assessment exercise and the prioritisation of capital schemes following the reduction in the capital grant?
Well, it did affect some of our thinking for programming, because post 2011, I couldn't quite say what date, we did know that it was unlikely that heavy goods vehicles would be using the existing crossing, the existing Forth Road Bridge. So that allowed us to reduce the return period, as we call it, for loading, i.e. what's the probability of this certain convoy of heavy goods vehicles sitting adjacent to the tower and producing this maximum load which would cause the overstress? Now, if you're assuming there's 100 years that the probability of that might occur in 100 years, then the probability changes if you've only got 5 years. It doesn't change very much, actually. It doesn't allow you much of a reduction, but it does give you something. So that was something else we could put in our considerations for analysing the truss end links.
So the fact that the existing bridge had a limited lifespan at its current capacity was a factor in determining these decisions about managing risk and prioritising.
A limited lifespan as far as the traffic loading was concerned. I wouldn't like to use the words limited lifespan for the bridge, but a lifespan, a limited traffic loading.
Okay.
Could I also say that was discussions we had as well, because there's quite a number of issues that weren't sorted out, and I don't know if they still are, about what would be able to be used the old bridge. As you'll know, there was a proposal for the original crossing when it was called Green, before it was called the Queen's Ferry Crossing, about whether it would be how many lanes it was, what traffic it would take, how would the old bridge be used. So there wasn't that clear. And remember the discussion, there wasn't a clear direction, and there's also issues about taxis, issues about farm use from vehicles, etc. And I think that's only just been clarified, if it has been clarified, and kept up to date, because not responsible. So I think we were very well aware that we weren't clear exactly for quite a long time of what the old bridge, if you want to, or the existing bridge, yeah, would be used for in the future. So therefore it wouldn't really, we might have influenced, but I don't think it would have, we wouldn't have known that absolutely definitely. And remember the discussion, we weren't clear exactly what the use of the existing bridge would be once the new bridge was open, because those decisions took some time to take.
Okay, thank
that
you.
That conversation had started back in my time on the board,
in fact, once it was decided to build the new bridge, as to quite what the demarcation of traffic between the two bridges would be. And eventually it seemed to be crystallising, although as we're hearing it didn't finally crystallise till fairly recently, but it seemed to be going in the direction of most traffic would go on the new bridge and only a limited amount of traffic would use the existing bridge, and therefore the existing bridge wouldn't need so much heavy work done to it, or major work, because it would be able to cope with a lighter load, as Barry was saying. If there's no 40-ton lorries going over the new bridge, it wouldn't be taking the same impact as before.
Okay, thank you. Alec Johnson's been waiting patiently to ask his questions.
Thank you very much. I have some finishing off questions, but I also have a question that relates to what we've just been discussing, because I hear what's being said, but there's still something I don't understand about the funding loops that were going on here. Transport Scotland believe they were setting the budget to fit the priorities. We've heard from you today that you believe you were setting the priorities to fit the budget. It's almost as if you were both sitting there in the front seat of the car, each believing that the other was driving. So who was driving?
Well, if you take it that who was setting the budget, pre-tolls, when tolls were there, then it was totally FETA's responsibility in terms of income, in terms of borrowing and setting the budget, and the governance was our responsibility in decision-making. And the indicative capital budget, which we've discussed before, but I think it's worth repeating, was put forward as an investment in the bridge, and these were the priorities for the FETA board and for the Bridgemaster in terms of going forward. And that's the way we believed we were working with Transport Scotland. A spending review then came forward and then cut what we expected the funding to be. So therefore, we had to then fit the priorities with the budget that we had. Now, whether they believed that, but that's the reality of it. It's in a report. It's round in black and white, and Transport Scotland were aware of that. So the budget, the priority, they were our priorities. This is an indicative budget that we wanted to invest in the bridge over that coming year, I think from 2012-13 onwards, and we had reserves, etc., we could use as well. But then that spending review happened, and we got less money than what we were expecting, and therefore we then had to set the priorities, and some of the projects, including the replacing the truss end links, we couldn't then afford because we didn't have the money, and we couldn't borrow because we didn't have the tolls, and we could borrow, but we couldn't then pay it back because we have to get money from Transport Scotland. So basically, as I understand it, and my understanding is, we set the priorities, taking all the risk into account, with the budget set by Transport Scotland.
So you're confident that you were not in control of the pace at which your priorities were addressed?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I don't know.
Certainly agree. As soon as the tolls were removed, the bridge was dependent on Transport Scotland's chequebook.
But to continue your analogy, if I can, it was like a car with dual controls. I'm sorry, that's the way it was, and it was complicated for us to work within that structure. But you know, there's always going to be problems, because if the total funding had come from bridge tolls, folk in Fife were getting increasingly upset about the possibility of huge increases that were mooted at that time. So the funding had to come from somewhere, and given the ageing structure and the increasing loads in the bridge, that bill was always going to be higher and higher and higher. So consequently, if Transport Scotland and the government hadn't been funding the bridge, then the motorists would be, and you would be looking at maybe £5 or £10 tolls. And I don't think that was politically acceptable to the folk of Fife.
I think that's maybe answered the question I still had in my mind.
And also, to be fair, that's a decision that was taken by the Scottish Government, but perhaps the long-term investment on who was going to pay for that wasn't thought through. That would be my view. Was it thought through? You took the tolls off there was a demand from some of the public. You took the tolls off. If that income then wasn't coming in order to then be invested, and therefore the money had to come from somewhere, and it had to come from the Scottish Government and from Transport Scotland, or from some of our reserves, because that's the only alternative we had.
Yeah. And the tolls coming off the bridge were widely supported in Fife.
Yeah. If I could pick up what Lesley was saying there, that I don't think the government had really thought through all the implications of taking the tolls off. We had a meeting with the then Transport Minister, Stuart Stevenson, when he eventually came to meet the FETA board to discuss the removal of tolls and all that meant. We had to invite him to come. He didn't offer to come, in fact. And obviously, a number of the questions there that we raised, he hadn't got answers to. One in particular that I recall asking was, if we're no longer needing to collect tolls, we no longer need people to collect the tolls. Fair enough, some of them could be redeployed, but a fair number of them would end up being redundant. What was going to happen to the redundancy payments? Who was going to fund them? And obviously, the government hadn't thought of that. The minister and his advisor beside him looked in horror when that question was raised. So I think that's just an indication of how much of a rush job it was taking the tolls off, rather than having thought through the whole implication. As it happened, they did agree, or the minister had to agree to stand behind the board to pick up the tab for the redundancies, which were an unquantifiable figure at that point. But that was just one indication that I can give of the lack of thought that went into the process at that stage.
I said I had some finishing off questions, and I'll move on to these. The first one is, we've spoken about this problem as one that could or could not have been foreseen, but are there any other parts of the bridge that we should be concerned about, either because of the condition or because of the level of stress that they are involved?
There's a list, if you want, on Appendix 4, which was on the 20th of February 2015, which is the second last meeting of FETA. And as I said, I was very clear in my opening remarks. There was two issues with staffing, retention of staffing of our expertise, but also ensuring that we handed over the bridge with all the information. And there is a list of, I think, around about 80 million, I think, Barry, at the time, which is saying, in order for the bridge still to keep open and to invest and put in maintenance, then these are the projects that Amy and Transport Scotland need to consider. I don't know, Barry, you can do more detail.
I think it would be fair to ask that question of the people who are responsible, who are Amy and Transport Scotland. We certainly set down post May 2015 what we felt the requirements, what the requirements we felt were needed to carry out a capital programme on Forth Road Bridge, and they're there in the public domain that can be seen. But I think that question should best be answered by the current contractor and for Transport Scotland.
But with hindsight, people always say, you know, with hindsight, but at the time I remember very clearly saying, as a board, we need to make sure we handle all the information because we don't want to get the blame that we haven't handed over everything, that we haven't have done everything by the book, and we've got a good organisation that's run well and has actually handed it over. So I hate to say that I maybe had that feeling that something might happen, but 6 months in after FETA is abolished, then we have got that problem, and I'm so pleased that all the information that we handed over to Amy was there. But what's happened after that in terms of June, we don't know, because obviously it's not a public body that has its documents, etc., in the public domain. Mm-hmm.
But I presume that there were, as there would be with a thing like the bridge, there would be a list of issues that you would have been aware of were planning for in the longer term.
Yes.
Yeah. That would be an ongoing thing. All the time I was on the board, we had the list of work in progress or work to be done. And as you've heard before, it was worked on a risk-based basis of how we allocated that work, or we agreed to it. Mm-hmm. And obviously that continued right up to the last day of FETA.
Yeah. We were told at the last meeting of the committee that the new Queensferry crossing will be subject to continuous structural health monitoring, and that a system was being applied there. Is that something that could be considered, should be considered for the Fourth Road Bridge in future?
Well, again, I'd have to say that would be a decision for Amy and Transport Scotland. I can only say that we did install a number of pieces of structural health monitoring on the bridge, but as I think I said earlier, structural health monitoring is very useful, but mainly if you've got an indication of a problem. It's like health monitoring in general. It's if you think about heart monitoring, would you put a heart monitoring in the whole of the population and hoping that you'll spot those who may have a problem later on? And that's the kind of thing we were looking at in Fourth Road Bridge. There are thousands of individual members. Which one do you monitor? Mainly monitoring is done, or has been done to date, on issues or problems on existing structures. There's a problem, you put a monitor on and monitor that problem for a limited period of time until you see the progress of the problem. Monitoring whole structures has not been done that often, whole big structures over a significant period of time. Queensferry Crossing is one. Ching Ma has been done. There have been issues with data collection, whether we're collecting the right amount of information. And if you spend money in doing these things, the money is going from doing other things, of course, because we all have a limited pot of money. So you've got to look at it again in a prioritisation basis. Structural health monitoring certainly has a place in the industry, but it's still a developing place in the industry.
Brief supplementary.
Yes. Well, that begs the question, Mr. Colford, if you are recommending replacement of truss end links at a significant cost of £15 million, surely that would point to the need to have structural health monitoring of the truss end links. So why didn't you consider that?
Because the weakest part that we had identified were the welds within the truss end links, and we were carrying out a close inspection of those welds of the truss end links. The truss end links are a part of the bridge which there are part components of the bridge which need to be replaced before the life of the structure itself, and the truss end links are part of that family of components. So that was why they were reaching 50 years old, therefore we felt that they had to be replaced.
Well, but you also pointed out that it was extremely difficult to actually inspect the pins. And
it is.
Given that it was extremely difficult to inspect the pins, would that not also identify a need for structural health monitoring of the pins?
At the time, we didn't think or didn't feel there were any issues with the pins.
Yes, but you'd already pointed out in an earlier question to me that there were issues with the pins in the Humber Bridge.
There were.
And I assume there's also issues with pins and other suspension bridges across the world. So surely that should have flagged up there was perhaps a need to investigate this particular issue.
The pins at Humber displayed signs of wear and signs of distress. Therefore, they were replaced. I'm not sure that there was much permanent monitoring done at Humber. We were aware that we couldn't inspect the pin and we couldn't grease the pin, but we carried out an inspection of the areas adjacent to the pin. The pin itself, as I understand it, hasn't failed. It's the members adjacent to it,
yes,
that have failed, as I understand it, although I say I haven't been involved in the analysis.
But I come back to the point about... Sorry, Convener. It's just this particular point about structural health monitoring was clearly you can't put something like that across every part of the bridge, but surely it should be in those parts of the bridge you have concerns with that might alter your prioritisation for capital programmes. So
yes.
I'm just wondering why that wasn't done here.
But again, you've got to look at the risk and what's involved in the risk and whether you should spend money and time and resource looking at that particular member or another member. And we were the risk priority was members which might cause structural collapse. That wasn't one of them. The failure of that particular member would have caused an operational issue, not a collapse issue.
But in hindsight, would it have helped to determine the possibility of something being done sooner if you had that structural health monitoring in to identify the problem?
With the benefit of hindsight, would I have... I couldn't remember the second part was...
If the structural health monitoring had been in place, it would flag up there was an issue with the pin that needed to be...
Possibly, yes, possibly.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You have to say that wouldn't have been a cheap option.
It would have been a difficult thing to do, and I'd have assumed it would be an expensive option as well.
Could I also say as well as the kind of monitoring, etc., one of the reasons why we wanted to have the Bridgemaster and the senior team in place is because of their experience, and they knew the bridge like the back of their hand, I would say, and they had that expertise. And while you might look at monitoring, they knew that bridge, and that's one of the reasons why, as a FETA board, we were very keen to keep the Bridgemaster and the senior team in place to make sure when we handed that over, and they had that expertise and that knowledge and experience of the bridge. And I think that's pretty crucial as well.
Okay, thank you for that. Alex.
I was going to finish off with a comment, a question about the antithesis of structural health monitoring, which is the why it's been done. And speaking to the minister, who had been advised by his engineers, he told me early in this process that if the truss end links work had been done, this problem would have been avoided. But that would have been a byproduct. It would have been a bit of a lucky break that the work would have been done without it previously having been discovered. But is that not, to an extent, to fundamentally misunderstand the nature of maintenance of old machinery, in that invariably when you take things apart and put them back together again, you discover things that you didn't know were there, you replace parts as you go along, and that failure to deal with these issues is in fact a risk factor in being caught out in the way that we were?
Well, that's difficult to answer. What all we...
It wasn't meant to be an easy question.
I'm not actually quite sure what the question was. It sounded more of a statement than a question, but we had identified a need to replace the truss end links. And there was a feeling, not just because the truss end links were showing to be and it was a serious issue we felt at the time on the overstress of the... We first discovered the overstress in the welding. But we looked at it from an engineering point of view. But they were getting on 50 years old. It was one element of the bridge that we considered for replacement and put it in our capital programme for replacement. That was an absolute decision in 2011 or 2010 to put it in the capital programme for replacement. But it was one of a number of issues on the bridge that had to be dealt with. Mm-hmm. There were a number of issues. Our focus at that time was on the main cable anchorages and the main cable. Having been removed from it from 5 years, it's difficult to actually remember how intense that period was for dealing with the main cable and the main cable anchorages. We really had concerns over the main cable anchorages at the time and the main cable.
Can I just add a wee bit from my own experience, life experience? Preventive maintenance often causes more problems than it solves, or it purports to solve. If you take your car into the garage, there's many times it comes back with more problems than it went in. And it's the same.
Depends on your mechanic.
Well, it does. It's a difference in philosophy, and a lot of people say you should just not go into a preventive maintenance thing. On the sensors problem, if I can, I mean, I don't know any sensor that would monitor the season up of that bearing on the thrust end links. I mean, how could that be done? You know, it's not a visual inspection would maybe show it up, but it's very, very difficult. Like I said right at the very beginning, you could do it through ultrasonics or X-ray technology, but that would be very difficult in practical terms to have a permanent monitoring of these components. And as Barry has said, which components do you decide on this very complex structure? A structure which I might add is really like a ship rather than a road bridge. It's in a marine environment, and it's got all the problems of marine environments of saltwater ingress and things like that. They all impact, and it probably is a factor in the bearing seizing up. You know, it's not an easy thing to look after the bridge, and we've kept it going. She's getting to be an old elderly lady. There will have to be funding supplied there for the next 50-100 years, because it's a listed building as far as I know now. So somebody's got to commit to funding the bridge despite it having a much lower loading in the future. It will still need to be looked after because of the environment that it lives in.
Do you have any further questions, Alex?
That's been finished.
Can I ask if members have any final questions that they'd like to ask? Claire.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Colford, earlier on you said that had the Truss End Link project gone ahead, and I appreciate it wasn't scoped and the full technical specification hadn't been done, you said it would have resulted in considerable disruption. Could you give us an indication of what that disruption would have likely have been and how long it would have lasted?
Well, at the time, when what we knew was we had an engineering solution, we could do the work. We knew we'd gone to the point of where we knew it could be done. The next stage of that was advertising for a consulting engineer to design it, and then the consulting engineer would put together a design, and then we would get a contractor on board to carry out the works. It's at that point that the determination of disruption occurs. What we did know at that point was that there was likely to be some disruption to users. Now, as we know, even closing a lane in Forth Road Bridge for 4 hours causes significant disruption to users. Therefore, it would be difficult to say at that point during the feasibility study that we were at that there would be no disruption to users. But it would only be when we got the contractor on board and got the contractor's method of working and how much, where would the balance be between closures of the carriageway and the cost of the works. The cheapest way of doing it would have been to shut the bridge and allow the contractor to get on with it. Not able to do that, that's one extreme. The other way would be to try and minimise the number of closures, which we would have done, but the cost then starts going up because the contractor has to work at difficult hours. So it's difficult to say what that would be because we hadn't reached that stage. That stage comes quite later, but we would have been telling people to expect disruption. But I would say that my past experience in the bridge, when we resurfaced during the weekends on a carriageway, we would put out a huge publicity campaign to tell people to stay away, don't come. And it didn't work as well as we would like to work, because people, human nature is that people still come and expect that their neighbours isn't going to go, but they'll be okay. And it's very difficult to do that. So there is that balance. If we carried out the works themselves, they would have likely have caused major disruption. They would have been planned, and that disruption would have been advertised. But I think my experience has been there would still have been disruption.
Thank you.
Okay, are there any further questions from members? No. Can I ask the witnesses if they have any final comments that they would like to make? And I'm conscious, Mr. Tracey, that you've not
contributed to the
consciously keep them quiet.
It's okay, you used to do that at board meetings as well.
Barry's sort of covered most of the issues as far as I'm concerned. I mean, a couple of things maybe to reiterate is that the capital plan was based on our programme of inspections from structural assessments and from operational needs. And that was how we established the plan in the first place. I think going forward, the asset management, the work prioritisation is something that the bridge managers, the asset managers in general, use every day, you know, throughout the UK, throughout the world for that matter, and that, you know, we go through and assess, you know, following inspections, following assessments, and prioritise schemes. We have to prioritise them because there isn't a finite budget available to carry out all the work and all the assets throughout the country. So I don't think the process that we went through was any different than what happens on a day-to-day basis, as I say, throughout the country.
Okay, I knew it was worth having you here.
There you go.
For that contribution. Thank you very much. Do witnesses have any final comments they would like to make to place on the record?
I just think that to me, it's actually made me more focused as well, in terms of, and it's been quite interesting, the discussion, the questions, sort of flatty will get you everywhere as well, and questions have been very detailed. And yeah. But I do genuinely think the opening statements about the three decisions that were taken out with FETA, and the board and the professionalism that we had, and FETA's reputation, to me, is really important going forward. And I hope we've given evidence today that has proven that as a board. I think the only time we actually ever had a vote when I was the convener was when we wanted to put a certain flag on the top of the bridge, if I remember, and there was a vote for that.
That wasn't the skull and crossbones, was it?
I think you know what it probably would be.
I'm asking.
Yes, a bit like, well, we're not going to that either.
We try to operate in the committee on the basis of consensus as well.
Well, exactly. And I think, you know, hopefully what we've done today is proven with the questions and that you've given and the answers we've given that FETA board and the professional body put forward and left the bridge in a good condition in terms of the situation, the spending it had.
Okay, thank you very much. It only remains for me to thank all of our witnesses for their attendance this morning and for their openness and willingness to engage in such a constructive way with the committee. We also appreciate not just your attendance, but the detailed documentation that you have forwarded to the committee. That's been invaluable in our deliberations. So thank you once again. And thank you, Mr. Colford. We recognise that your commute today has been slightly longer than that for the rest of us. So we now move this meeting into private session. Thank you.